This presentation is designed to help explain the real value of power modules. We will take a detailed look into one of the aspects related to power module design and reliability, which is high temperature storage. Today we will discuss what is high temperature storage, why it matters, and also a few case studies. High temperature storage demonstrates a component's ability to withstand elevated temperatures for prolonged periods of time and still function as intended. This is important because power supplies get hot and customers want them to last for a long time. Specifically for modules, customers expect the entire module to last as long as the silicon. TI's standard high temperature storage testing takes 6 weeks to complete. The device is baked in an unbiased fashion at 150 degrees C. During engineering development, only the inductor is HTS tested. However, during module qualification, the entire module is HTS tested. This allows us to catch inductor failures sooner in the development process. The inductor is first mounted to a coupon board to facilitate automated testing. Once a week, the inductors are removed from the temperature chamber and measured, and then they are placed back in the chamber for the next week. High temperature storage can adversely affect the inductor. Not all inductor types are prone to HTS failure. Ferrite inductors do not have this problem, but powdered iron cores do. This is also commonly known as thermal aging. Here is the root cause for high temperature storage inductor failures. Over extended periods of time at elevated temperatures, the coating and/or binders of the iron powder begin to break down, reducing the AC impedance of the molding material. The reduced AC impedance appears across the inductor terminals or between turns, causing increased core loss and lower power supply efficiency. When operating in a switching power supply, the problem is most evident at higher input voltages and at higher switching frequencies. It is most easily spotted by comparing efficiency data pre and post HTS testing. But there are other measurement methods that can reveal an HTS failure as well. Here is an example of an inductor that has failed high temperature storage testing and its impact on power supply efficiency. The left graph shows the power supply efficiency before HTS stress. The right graph shows the power supply efficiency after HTS stress. As you can see, the power supply efficiency post HTS stress is very poor. At 50 volts input, the efficiency has dropped by over 30%. This example clearly shows that the inductor is failing high temperature storage and it should not be considered for this design. Here is the same example showing the power supply power dissipation. The left graph shows the power supply power dissipation before HTS stress. The right graph shows the power supply power dissipation after HTS stress. As you can see, the power dissipation post HTS stress is very poor. At 50 volts input, the power dissipation has increased by almost 12 watts. Again, this data clearly shows that this inductor is failing high temperature storage. Here is some data from a different example, but it shows an inductor that is also failing HTS. Let's discuss a little deeper what is changing within the inductor. This inductor was measured using an LCR analyzer. The left graph shows the inductance over time, measured at three different test frequencies. Notice that the inductance is not changing much over time. There is no problem here. The right graph shows the AC resistance of the inductor versus test frequency, both pre and post HTS stress. The AC resistance of the inductor is a function of test frequency, so it is normal for the AC resistance to increase as a function of test frequency. However, if you compare the pre and post data, you will see that the AC resistance has degraded significantly after HTS stress. One thing to note is that there's almost no difference in the pre and post data if the inductor test frequency is low, around 100 kHz. This is important because almost every inductor vendor uses 100 kHz as their benchmark frequency when evaluating their own inductors. This data clearly shows that the inductor AC resistance has degraded simply due to HTS stress. Let's discuss two more methods you can use to measure inductor HTS performance. Using an LCR analyzer, the Q of the inductor can be measured. Q is defined as inductive reactance divided by DC plus AC resistance. It can be measured at a certain test frequency. In this case, we are using 100 kHz, 500 kHz, and 1 MHz. The left graph shows the Q over time at each test frequency. Notice that at 100 kHz, the Q is roughly constant over time. However, at 1 MHz, the Q is clearly dropping with time. This indicates that the AC resistance of the inductor is increasing. The right graph shows the DC resistance of the top surface of the inductor core. A simple resistance meter can be used to measure the top surface of the inductor core. In a good inductor, the surface resistance will be very high, greater than 50 million ohms. However, as the inductor ages, the surface resistance will drop over time, indicating an HTS failure. Not all inductors are created equal. Here is an example of an automotive inductor. The vendor datasheet specifies this inductor as AEC Q200 and gives an operating temperature range up to 150 degrees C, which includes ambient temperature plus inductor self-heating. In order to accelerate the HTS testing, this part was stressed at 170 degrees C for 6 weeks. Looking at the Q versus time graph, it appears that the inductor is doing okay. However, this is an example where Q did not reveal much degradation because the test frequency was not high enough. In addition, this is a low-value inductor, only 470 nanohenries, so Q is relatively low to begin with. Let's see how this inductor holds up to the other measurement techniques. Here's the same inductor measured in two other methods. The left graph shows that the surface resistance of the inductor is clearly dropping over time as the inductor ages. The right graph shows what happens when this inductor is used in a switching power supply. This is a test that most inductor suppliers do not normally do as part of their component qualification. The pre- and post-power dissipation are not the same. In fact, the post-HTS data shows the power dissipation has doubled at 4-amp load. Now, this is an automotive-grade inductor. Why didn't the vendor see this HTS failure during their own qualification? It is because they only measured inductance at 100 kHz and DC resistance as their pass-fail criteria for their component integrity. TI has learned that all inductors are not created equally. We have tested many, many vendors for HTS performance. And there are many inductor manufacturers who create average inductors and only a few who create great inductors. Which inductor do you want in your power supply? TI chose vendor E. This presentation has showed some of the value that a power module brings. Specifically, TI puts a lot of effort into qualifying and selecting the right components to ensure we are providing reliable products to our power module customers. Power modules bring value in other ways as well. They are simple and easy to use. They are able to achieve high power density, oftentimes even higher than discrete solutions. They enable fast time to market. In addition, power modules are fully characterized for electrical, thermal, and EMI performance. When it comes to power module design, TI sweats the details. For more information, visit ti.com/powermodules.